intentionally did not put any bills on the calendar for today because we're blessed to have the superintendent with us. The superintendent is joined by Troy Oshner. Troy Oshner is the deputy superintendent for health. Many of you know Stacey Rowland, who is the deputy of the head of governmental affairs department, and Tom Zyra, who's right to her right, who's the assistant. And it's really an honor for me to introduce the superintendent. And I was thinking now that I used to be an outsider in the Capitol, and now that's probably changed a little bit, but I suppose I'd still better this kind of climate, like be considered an outsider. But of all the superintendents that I've dealt with over many years, the current superintendent to me is unequivocally the most accessible and knowledgeable about issues and involved in issues and willing to discuss them with the industry, willing to discuss them with the legislature. And it's made, at least from my perspective, the job so much easier and so much more seamless. And it's an honor to have the superintendent here with us today. Without further ado, Superintendent Jim Wren.
Thank you very much, Senator. Really nice to see
you. Jim, it's comfortable for you.
It's okay. I'll just sit if it's okay with everyone. Thank you very much. I must also say that having Senator Breslin as the chair of the committee has made my job very, very easy. And it's I know we're going to do a lot of good things for the people of the state of New York, not only this coming session, but hopefully, you know, for down the road as well. When I first accepted the appointment, and I actually appeared in this room for my confirmation hearing, one of the priorities that I had mentioned would be that we would address certain issues that needed special attention. One of the areas that needed almost immediate attention was the medical malpractice area, and specifically with respect to medical malpractice insurance. And there's a problem with the insurance that really could be narrowed to two specific areas. One is on the rate setting process in the front. When I came in, there had been no rate increase for the prior 2 years. And everyone, no matter how you were involved in the medical malpractice insurance area, felt that the process was over-politicized and it really didn't have the credibility it should have. The second problem area would be with the unfunded liability with MMIP, which is several hundred million dollars. And that was the responsibility of the medical malpractice insurance companies. And it really was a strain on their finances, and you know, to have to carry that on their financial statements made it difficult for them to you know, engage in the areas as they should. What I've done since I became superintendent was speak to a lot of people in the industry, in fact, all the stakeholders, and at this point, many times, to see if we could work something out to, as I say, right the ship, try to restore some credibility to the medical malpractice insurance industry in the state. And after speaking to everyone, we've come up with a proposal that we have also spoken to everyone about, which has two components. On the front end, to address the issue with respect to the rate setting process, we would like to form a rate servicing organization, pretty much the way they have it in the workers' comp arena. And I'll just give you the general overview, which would basically collect all the data from the insurance companies and come up with an advisory rate that they would provide the department with. All of the stakeholders would have a seat on the board or a seat at the table with the rate servicing organization. So they'd have input on the actuaries that are chosen, the assumptions that are made, and on the process itself. And the goal there would be to get a rate that everyone felt, number one, was credible, and based on objective data, and to remove some of the political influences from the process and from the rate that was set. And hopefully, at least initially, over the short term, stabilize the rate going forward. And we would do it right now without any process like this in place. The rate is subject to severe spikes. Even though we had no increase the last 2 years, without something like this, the rate could go up more than people would anticipate. By having an RSO in place and receiving an advisory rate, we could try to stabilize the rate going forward. And as an example, say the, and this, I'm not saying this is what the recommendation would be, but I'm just using it for purposes of an example. Say the rate servicing organization this year came up and said the rate should, you should increase rates 10%. Well, after considering other things, the reasonableness and other factors, we might say, okay, this year it'll be 6%. Now we know we're 4% behind. Next year, the rate servicing organization may come in and say 4%. We might keep it at 6%. Now we're just 2% behind, you know, going forward. So what we've done in the short term is to stabilize the rate going forward, take the spikes out of it, and put a process in place where the practitioners can have some comfort and be able to plan on what the rate might be going forward. With respect to the unfunded liability, we've spoken to a number of people, especially people in the property and casualty field, and they have agreed to work with us because they know it really wouldn't, we wouldn't be able to erase that liability anytime in the certainly near future if we didn't have the cooperation of the entire P&C industry. And they've worked with us, and they said if you do something to assure them that there will be credibility on the rate setting process going forward, we'll work with you on a short-term basis to erase that liability with MMIP. And the way it was recommended, it would be that it would be a pass-through assessment. And it would only last as long as the assessment, the assessment was necessary to wipe out that unfunded liability, and it would then end. And if it was spread over the entire P&C industry, it would really have minimal impact on everyone. But again, they made a condition that we do have confidence on the front end that that there would be a credible rate setting process in place that 3 years down the road or 5 years down the road or 7 years down the road, we're not back again with another liability that has to be addressed. We presented this to a number of people, and at several meetings we've had people come up unsolicited and speak to people in the department that with other insurance companies, and they said, if that is done, we would consider entering the market as well. So not only, if that does occur, not only will we have stabilized the rates short term, but hopefully rates start to actually decrease because we'll have created a competitive marketplace so other carriers could come in. And I think that would be something that benefits everyone tremendously. With this rate servicing organization, we can do other things down the road. The data that is collected at some point will be standardized, and we'll be able to use that in considering other things that should be considered for the medical malpractice industry. We're also looking at tort reform measures. We're working with Justice Fow and Dr. Danes from the Department of Health on a pilot project with the courts to see if we can streamline the process. Costs of litigation have gone up significantly over the last few years, and if we're able to streamline the process a little, that would remove a lot of the costs that are encountered by everyone involved in the litigation process, but specifically doctors who could win a case at the end and still have several hundred thousand dollars worth of doctor's bills that have to be addressed. One other area that we're looking at, and this is with respect to health insurance, is prior approval, and we're meeting with stakeholders on that. And like we do with everything, what we're trying to do is present the stakeholders with a proposal, meet with them, on several occasions, get their input, and try to work together and arrive at something that really works. With prior approval, we do have people that have very strong feelings, you know, on each side of it. But we feel we've gotten to a point now where we really have to be able to get involved earlier rather than later. Right now with file and use, we have to wait 15 months before we start getting the data that will be necessary on to evaluate whether or not the rate charged 15 months earlier was fair and was proper. As a realistic matter, because of the length of time it takes to get the data and then to evaluate it and make decisions on how to proceed, you're talking about 21 months at a minimum before we'd be able to do anything with respect to the rate that was set. What's happened in the interim is not only do we have an issue with that rate, but a second year's rate has been set. So it makes it very unworkable. In addition, if there was something improper done with the rate that was sent 21 months earlier, the people who have to pay that rate are already affected by it, and it's nice to get a refund or to get some other type of redress. Many of them may have had to drop out of coverage and may have, you know, gone without coverage, or with respect to the state, may have ended up on a public plan where the taxpayers are responsible for it. There are statistics that we provided, you know, in support of this. I know between 96 and 1999, when we last had prior approval, the average rate increase was 5.6% or thereabout. From 2000 to 2007, I believe it was almost 14%. I think it was 13.96. Now, the increase wasn't due solely because of the fact we didn't have prior approval. There were other factors that caused the increase, but it was a factor. And we see what's going on now, not only in New York, but around the country, and 25 other states have prior approval. We think the time has come for that. We've already started hearing comments from people affected. Senator Breslin has expressed, among other concerns, a concern that he doesn't want this to increase the amount of time it takes for an insurance company to receive a decision on whether or not their request will be accepted. So we're looking into things we're able to incorporate to address his concerns, and many other concerns that I won't go into. But that is also going to be a priority for the department going forward. What I can do is maybe hit upon a few other priorities, and then if it's okay, open it up for any questions people may have on specific issues they may want me to address. Guarantee fund. Right now, the life insurance guarantee fund is capped on how much it can handle. We are going to increase that, and we're working with the insurance committees in the Senate and the Assembly, as well as with Life Insurance Council of New York and others, to make sure that whatever is done in a proper way. And that will be a priority because we have issues right now where the maximum amount can be, you know, can be an issue. Producer licensing for agents and brokers, we're working now to try to standardize the application process so that it's somewhat uniform throughout the United States. We're working with the NAIC on that. With that said, because the terms agent and broker are so, interrelated or incorporated in our insurance law statutes, we will maintain those distinctions for insurance law purposes, but for licensing purposes, we'll try to follow the producer standards that are being followed or being used throughout by other states. Licensing of title insurance agents. Although we regulate title insurance companies, we do not regulate title insurance agents. We feel that this is a necessary step at this time for a variety of reasons, so we are going to be looking to do that as well. We've already met on several occasions with all of the stakeholders in the life insurance field, and again, we're trying to work with them to the extent we can to work together on arriving at something that will work. Auto insurance, we've seen a tremendous increase in loss experience, especially with respect to the no-fault area, to the point where we have to really address the situation. At the department, we're doing it three ways. Number one is we're getting much more aggressive and looking to work with people in the industry and others to increase our fraud investigations. We believe if we can increase those investigations, we'll have a chilling effect and discourage, not only providers but claimants and others, from engaging in activities that definitely drive up the rates. A second thing is our regulation, Reg 68. We've already proposed an amendment to it. We've posted online. We've met with almost all of the stakeholders at this time. We've received the comments. We're now reviewing all of the comments, and what we'll probably do is have a revised Reg 68 for people to consider again, and then meet with the stakeholders again before we put something out there. With respect to coastal insurance, there is supposed to be formed a temporary panel on homeowners insurance. We have a lot of things we're considering in the homeowners area, but we're really not looking to put the cart before the horse. We're trying to get that panel set up so that we can work through them on many of the issues that we'll want to address. And there's a host of other areas that we're working on, but I think at this point it might be best if I open up for questions.
First on the panel.
Sure.
St. John's, you're okay with me?
Open it up to the audience for any questions.
And one quick question.
Sure.
The coastal, you would imagine we could have been so far over the past several years, we could have been able to do something more with that. Why is it taking so long, and why are we going to, three people before we set up?
Well, the panel will be set up soon. We're really working to get everyone to put their members on it. As far as coastal, right now, we really don't have a capacity issue, we have a pricing issue. And so that's the issue. And we are working with the industry to address this, even though the panel's not there. And we have had great success. So we're hoping that, going forward, we're able to do something, with the panel, but it may not be as, as drastic or as significant as what we would have otherwise had to do.
If you could let the chairman know, obviously, when you come to some conclusion or some agreement, and that I could be made aware of that agreement.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Anyone else? I'm glad that the industry is so satisfied.
I don't know if satisfied. They've heard me say now a few times.
And I want to, I guess.
They're saying things under their breath right now.
Thank the superintendent for being here. Thank you all very much.